centers around the importance of Srila Prabhupada's books and how to approach these books.
I need to get my microphone and hook it up to this big microphone. Put it into the bottom, clip it on here.
So, this is a 65 slideshow presentation. And it's, I've done it about 10 times, but it's not my creation. It's put together by one very senior Prabhupada disciple named Mother Lakshmi Moni. She has developed this. And it was presented before the ILS a couple years ago. So, you'll find it very edifying, and of course interesting too. So it's not an entertainment program, so don't get the popcorn out and relax and wait for the commercials. It's not like that. It's about learning more deeply what is our responsibility in becoming a devotee. There isn't a responsibility, and that responsibility is to know what Srila Prabhupada has given us. And so this presentation will help us go deeper into what Prabhupada has given us, and it also mentions the dangers that can manifest and are starting to manifest within our ISKCON society if we don't really, what we say, put Prabhupada's books in a more prominent position in our lives and in the way that we present Krishna consciousness to the world. So, let's see how this thing works. This is, okay, it's not working. Does it have to be turned on? So this is very interactive. You won't be able to go to sleep. It's not possible because I'm going to ask you to read from the screen and also say something in relationship to what is being presented. So this is like something you're going to have to stay focused with because you raise your hand if you want to read and I'll call on you that way. Don't just read. I'll call on you and then if you want to read, raise your hand. And if nobody raises their hand, then I'll raise your hand for you. You don't mind. Not physically, but audibly. Okay, so how does this thing work? But I have to be able to change the slides. You're able to change the slide change? I have to keep saying next, right? It's not gonna, it's supposed to work from here.
Maharaj, I think the USB within that is not connected there.
Do you have a USB for this?
Maharaj, it's missing actually.
It's so missing?
Yeah.
Oh, that's nice.
Sorry.
Okay.
Okay, why is it more important to study Srila Prabhupada's books more deeply now than ever before? Srila Prabhupada, keys. And next slide. Four generations, next. First generation, second, wait, one at a time. First generation is Srila Prabhupada, our founder Acharya. He's the first generation within the society. Second is his direct disciples, those who took direct initiation from him. Third is disciples of his disciples. How many of you are like that? Okay, raise your hand. Disciples of the disciples. We have so many. Now there's another group, number four. Disciples of the disciples of his disciples. I don't think there's too many there. but it will come in the future. So here we got four categories of personalities. Srila Prabhupada, his direct disciples, those who took initiation from his disciples, and then those disciples also will eventually become gurus and give and have their own disciples. Four generations. Next. Four categories. How many buttons did you push? Okay. Four categories. Now, Prabhupada's books can be understood from four angles of vision. What are the issues that's mentioned in his books and his lectures? So, problems that may arise, or significant decisions. Where does it stay going? It's up there, but it's not on the screen. Doesn't work on that screen, very nice. Okay, so try to follow along, because this is really important that I somehow guide the information by visual here. So, problems that may arise or significant decisions that may be. What are some of the significant decisions that we have to deal with? What is one of them that's going on in this time right now? Big one.
Need more reading.
No, this is a discussion, it's a contention.
Female dictionary gurus.
Issue. It's an issue. Okay. So we need to go to Srila Prabhupada to also help us resolve that issue. So issues. Second thing is, someone read?
Instructions. The information given by our founder Acharya to resolve issues.
Okay, so then, from the issues comes the formula for dealing with those issues, the instructions. And now instructions also are contextual. So the next one?
Context. The relevant situations which inspired that instruction and which shaped the particular instruction.
So within the context, there is also a particular relevancy that pertains to the issue that's being, it may not pertain to another issue, although it also is an instruction. So contextual. Sometimes we say don't take things out of context. Number four?
Intention. The goal which the Prabhupada was trying to achieve in giving a particular instruction.
Okay, so he gave an instruction. What was he trying to achieve by that instruction? Next one? Okay, so here are some of the issues. Looks like one of the former temple presidents there. Or maybe it's a GBC member, I don't know. Okay, so you have, these are initiations. You know, how can we somehow or other standardize initiation across the board where people get a fair evaluation and be able to become qualified for initiation. What is Diksha Guru? What is Shiksha Guru? Prabhupada's desire for Varnashra and preaching. How to preach, the different ways for preaching. Okay. Next. Instructions. Okay. Someone read.
As our spiritual leader and ultimate manager of authority, he left us.
Next.
Books, lectures, conversations, letters.
One more, isn't there?
Personal instructions, etc.
Okay. So this is what Prabhupada gave us. He gave us his books, we have his lectures, and then within context of speaking, Prabhupada also did conversations with his devotees and conversations with people outside. The letters, personal letters that Prabhupada responded to and also wrote. And then personal instructions means when he told someone directly what is their responsibility like that. Okay, so we got the five categories. This is all sequential. You'll see how it builds up. Next. Okay. So the context, who, what, when, where, what is the media, how was given, how that media was given within the context. Next. Time, place, and what's the last one? Circumstance.
You can use this to point in the screen, Maharaj.
Oh, this is good. You sure it'll work?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see how it works. You do it.
Sure.
Oh, okay. I have to put on the table.
Yes.
Okay, so where do I do push?
You move it around.
Okay, time, place, and circumstance. So what is the context, and how? What time was it given, what was the place, what was the people involved, and what was the media by which that instruction was given? Where was it given, who was it given to, when? You see the complexity. We're trying to understand what Srila Prabhupada has given us. All these things have to be taken into consideration. Otherwise, how will we clearly know what is the proper, what we say, goal of what Prabhupada said? Next slide. The intention, why was it given? Okay, next. Will, what is the motivation, the mood, the desire, purpose, all based on the intention. So, because Prabhupada, someone would say Prabhupada said this, someone said Prabhupada said this, someone said Prabhupada said this, and Prabhupada said all these things. But what was his intention when he said what he said? Can you think of a statement by Srila Prabhupada that is controversial and cannot be understood simply by reading it?
Women are not intelligent,
or Prabhupada said that same thing in different ways. But then what else did he say in relationship to the same statement?
Women have smaller brains?
No. We're going, don't reveal all these things.
They need to be protected.
No, in terms of the opposite of what she just said.
A Vaishnavi is the same intelligence as a Vaishnava?
In other words, once you become a devotee, that doesn't apply anymore. Yeah, that principle doesn't apply anymore. Because now you've transcended, or at least we hope you have, the bodily conception of life, and you're acting on the spiritual platform. Even if you're not on the spiritual platform, you're acting on the spiritual platform. Therefore, your intelligence is coming from higher authority. And your reasoning is also formulated by your activities in devotional service, which makes your the way you think is no longer based on bodily conception of life. So it applies and doesn't apply. So you have to understand the desire and purpose, what is the intention, and the mood by which it was given. Okay, that's another example of something that is a little contentual.
He said that, once he said that we should just hear the holy name, it's another thing. It was one answer to a devotee, to another devotee.
We should just hear the holy name.
Yeah, it's not to sing.
And not to respond?
Not to think.
Just hear.
Yeah, only your ears, just hear.
Yeah.
But on another occasion he said that we should... A devotee asked, can we think about Krishna's pastimes while chanting holy name? And he said, we must. So it's contradictory, but at the same
time. Appearance, yeah, but on one level it's true, and another level it's also true. Depends on the devotee, the level of spiritual advancement. Yeah, because he did say, just here, and other times he said that ultimately we need to absorb ourselves in Krishna when we chant. Okay. So that's a nice. So here, this is interesting here. We're going back to the four things: the issues, instructions, context, and the intention. So, first generation, that's Srila Prabhupada, right? So it's clear. The issues are clear, the instructions are clear, the context is clear, the intention is clear. So then, as the second generation, they know the issues, they have a clear, they have somewhat of an understanding of the instruction, and they can understand the context, but then they have to reawaken by understanding what Prabhupada's intention was. In other words, they may not have been there to hear what Prabhupada said, but then and therefore they will need to know whether it is that intention. So the intention starts to fade within the next generation. And then you follow that down, issues are there, instructions, context becomes a little bit more oblique, and the intention is practically hard to really resurrect, unless you actually go to people who were there and heard what Srila Prabhupada said directly. Then the fourth generation, disciples of the disciples of disciples, they still may know the issues. They're not too clear on how the instruction should be applied to the issues, and the context is lost, and the intention is not. These are tendencies that have been studied from other, what we say, religious organizations, and how time affects these four categories. That makes sense? Yeah. Any questions related to that? Okay, next. Second generation, hearing from Srila Prabhupada's direct disciples. Okay. So again, we're going into this. Let me get this thing. What is it? Okay, read this.
Attention missing or fading. Intention of our founder is not directly present. It must be reconstructed by knowing the instruction, finding the context in which it was given.
Okay, we mentioned that.
If these are unclear, it can lead to arguments.
Which it does, right? Okay.
And sometimes a different understanding gets stifled and confused.
In other words, if someone has a different opinion, that becomes the opinion. And the real opinion, or the correct one, gets lost. Okay, this is the second generation. Next. Third direction. Okay, someone read.
All Srila Prabhupada's disciples gone. Now we are hearing from disciples of Srila Prabhupada's direct disciples.
Okay.
Missing context and intention.
Next.
This must be reconstructed by memories from those who associated with direct disciples.
Yeah, so we want to reconstruct, go back. If we want to reconstruct what actually Prabhupada meant in the context and the intention, then have to go and associate with those direct disciples that were there. Just hearing from Prabhupada may not be enough, even if you would hear the recordings. You can't necessarily understand the intention. So a reconstruction program needs to be understood or implemented. Okay, so this is based on the chart we saw. Next one. Oh, when I hit click, yeah,
yes,
it's moving again.
Yes.
Oh, well, how do I go back now? You go back. Okay. I won't touch it. Okay. So how do I do it without moving it? Just
click.
Just push it down?
Yeah. Just don't click.
Oh, no clicks allowed.
Okay.
Just do it. Is there any IT here? Okay. Okay.
So this right.
There is menu down there on left.
Okay, go back.
Scroll down.
Where do I do the pointer? That's what I'm interested in.
Pointer.
Let's just move this. Oh, okay. 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 So, fourth generation, someone read.
Fourth generation. All association with those who directly associated with Srila Prabhupada is now gone.
So how do we bring it back? The fourth generation, disciples of the disciples of the disciples, here is the way to bring it back.
Missing,
read?
Missing direct instructions, context and intention, these now need to be reconstructed by a relevant system of education and careful study of those instructions practically.
The relevant system of education needs to be, in other words, seminars, programs, educational programs to reconstruct what Prabhupada said and his intention for what he said and how it relates to us. In other words, the whole program. Okay, next. Okay, this is a statement. Now this is one of the most important statements regarding Srila Prabhupada's books. Someone read, nice and loud.
Prabhupada comments.
Nice and loud.
Prabhupada comments. All the devotees connected with Krishna consciousness movement must read all the books that have been translated, the Chaitanya Charitamrita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita and others. Otherwise, after some time, they will simply eat, sleep and fall down from their position. Thus, they will miss the opportunity to attain the eternal blissful life of transcendental pleasure. Chaitanya Charitamrita.
This is one of the foundational verses in relationship to what Prabhupada wrote about the importance of reading his books. So he's giving us a little understanding that these four books were the foundations for building this movement and propagating this movement. If we don't take time to read and study these books, after some time we will lose that enthusiasm in our devotional service. We'll be going back to the activities of the body content. It's so important to read and study these books because it inspires the intelligence, it awakens Krishna consciousness, and it gets us off this material platform. And Prabhupada says, if we don't, then the opportunity for eternal blissful life will be missed. Very important verse. The purport is very short, it's not mentioned here. Prabhupada elaborates it in the purport. Okay, next.
You must study very scrutinizingly all of the books, so that when the need arises, you can repeat in your own words their purports. As much as possible, read, chant, and preach. This is our life and soul. If we keep to this simple formula, then there is no doubt that we will be victorious wherever we go, and very soon, we will become the only religion in the world. Letter to Vidyananda Swami, Jan 6, 1972.
Yeah, so what is this word here? How would you define that?
In detail,
right. To really in detail study Srila Prabhupada's books and then be able to take those words and explain it in your own words. In other words, it's not about just repeating it. Of course, that is sufficient. But when you repeat it in your own words, then you have an understanding of what is being said. And that is actually preaching or teaching. Okay, next. Someone else, read nice and loud.
If you want to stay in Krishna consciousness, you will have to develop firm faith in Guru and Shastra. Therefore, you must study my books very scrutinizingly.
Is that word again?
Follow the four regulated principles very strictly and chant 16 rounds daily, avoiding the 10 offenses. Do not take this movement as something cheap. Srila Prabhupada to Shukla Dev Das, 30th October 1976.
Yeah, so what Prabhupada was saying is that this is foundational to what we say, understanding what has been given to us in terms of our spiritual growth. It's not as something cheap. This movement is coming from the spiritual world, Goloka Prema Dhananam Sankirtan. And this philosophy and the knowledge contained within this philosophy will, going back to the previous verse, keep us off the bottom platform. that we simply follow these simple principles. Okay, next.
Therefore, I recommend you to read books more and more and try to understand the subject matter from different angles of vision and be always discussing it with your godbrothers. Mm. And when you are working and you cannot read, then listen to the tapes of my lectures and hear in that way. And never neglect to chant your 16 rounds of beads daily. Rise early without fail. Attend Mangala Arati, take bath, and follow the other regulative principles, and everything will come out very successfully. You can rest assured of that.
Yes, the Prabhupada ends by saying, it will come out successfully if you follow this simple formula. So, we might not be able to go to Mangala Arati and follow all of the other temple programs, but if we're living outside, we can also set up our own little routine of having a little Mangala Arati with the family, or listening to Srila Prabhupada chanting Mangala Arati. That's what I do every morning when I listen to his Mangala Arati prayer. And also read Srimad Bhagavatam and chant my rounds. So I set up a little morning program. So that's basically what he's saying. You need to have a foundation in your spiritual practice, and this is the foundation that he has established. And he said if you follow that, then rest assured. In other words, he's not saying that you may come out successful, you will come out successful. This is foundational. It's like, you know, when you are doing a mathematical problem and it's very complicated, you have to know basic arithmetic. In order to go to the higher principles of, you know, arithmetics. And so if you make mistakes in basic arithmetic, everything else will be wrong. So something foundational sets the stage for something greater to come. And this is foundational in everything. Chanting, having a morning program, whether you're home or in the temple, and following the regulative principles. Okay? Next. Someone else?
In my books, the philosophy of Krishna consciousness is explained fully. So if there is anything which you do not understand, then simply have to read again and again. By reading daily, the knowledge will be revealed, and by this process, your spiritual life will develop.
So what is the key point here about lack of understanding? How does that overcome?
Reading again.
Interpretation and reading. Okay. Have you ever seen that book, or I mean, I'm sure you have, Bhakti Siddhanta's presentation on Ramasamhita? Have you read that? Do you understand it? Nobody could understand it when Prabhupada presented it. So the devotees were reading it and said to Prabhupada, could you write a commentary or an understanding of what your spiritual master has given us in the form of the explanations of Bhagavad-gita? Papa said, you just read it over and over again. And this works. If you read something once, you may get some understanding. You read it again, and you think about what you're reading. That repetition of reading brings out the meaning. It's not a matter of having a lot of intelligence or not. That's not the question. It's just trying to understand and using the process of repetition. And then when you do it that way, then actually the knowledge starts to become clearer. So you can do that with any of Prabhupada's books. You read it over and over, and then you find that there's more and more meaning each time you read. And the point is, it's not important how much you read, it's more important how much you understand. That's the main point. So by repetition, you go deeper into principles. Okay. Okay. This is a famous verse. Jasya Devi Parav Bhakti Tata Devi Tata Guru Tasya Ekta Katita Ihi Yarta Pakisadhanta Mahatmanaha. So I'm going to read the translation.
One who has got unflinching faith in the Supreme Lord and similar faith in his spiritual master
to him only the import of Vedic knowledge becomes revealed.
Next slide. Oh no, okay, go back. The references is there somewhere at the bottom of the page. Can you see it on the computer?
No.
No, it's not there. Well, this is from the Svaita Sutara Upanishads, verse number 6.8. And this is very important because this faith in both Krishna and the spiritual master, and it's not, what kind of faith is it?
Unflinching.
What would be an example of unflinching faith in a verbal statement? Make a verbal statement that would indicate unflinching faith.
Faith that doesn't
fade
regardless of the circumstance.
Yeah, very good. Faith regardless of the circumstance. Or faith even without having a complete understanding of what is being said. It's not blind faith because the persons that you're putting faith in are qualified, both the Lord and the spiritual master. You've already accepted them. So when you put your faith in them, that's the principle of acceptance. So whatever they say is the absolute truth in terms of your relationship with them. So I was thinking of the statement, my spiritual master is wrong, but he's right. Any comments on that? He's wrong, but it seems like what he's saying is not correct, but because it's coming from him, it's right. Examples? Anybody? Yes.
Show faith in that simple statement of Prabhupada, and then after some days he left the moment.
Well, that was an issue with him. He was constantly bothered by that, what Prabhupada said about the moon landing. At one time, I'll tell you a little story, it was kind of an anecdote. So Prabhupada, they were cooking for Prabhupada, he was in the kitchen, and so the ghee caught on fire. And so the devotees came with a fire extinguisher onto the ghee, and it just blew smoke all over the place. And the devotees were saturated with soot all over. So Prabhupada called them, and they came in, and he was one of them, him and one of the other person. They came, and they paid their obeisances. And he was covered with soot, and Prabhupada said, oh, Purushottam, you have come to the moon. Prabhupada wasn't going to patronize his ignorance. So you had to be ready for whatever Prabhupada was going to give you. So thank you. That was a good example. Yeah, faith that is unflinching based on the fact that I have faith in these two, what we say, components of faith, the Lord and the Spirit. Next slide. Okay, now we're going to see about how to study Srila Prabhupada's books. So three types of study. First is personal study, your reading. Second is group study, studying with many devotees together. And the last is systematic group study. In other words, hearing presentations on the philosophy in a very systematic way, like seminars or, like that. So this is three ways you can approach the principles of studying Prabhupada's books. And we'll get into these three in the further parts of this. Next slide, please. Okay. Prayerful reading, a good system for personal study. Okay? So someone read.
Prayerful reading, bore an attempt to allow Shastra to affect us, gain association, carefully listen to Krishna's message, and in a potent transcendental voice, sink deeply into the core of our consciousness.
Don't be in a hurry. Try to absorb yourself in what is being said and let the Shastra is actually alive by thinking and also approaching it in the mood of prayer. The Shastra more or less reveals itself through our absorption. Carefully listening to Krishna's message. These are just tips on how to approach the Shastras. Yes? Next. Suggested steps when beginning to practice prayerful reading. Okay, so this is 10 steps. This is very, very important. You can, if you want, I'll give you a copy of this. These 10 things, this is how you can really approach Prabhupada's books. Okay, the first thing you do is?
Decide on what you will read.
Okay, choose what you're going to read, which book. Second?
How long you will read for. It is up to you.
Yeah, it's up to you, but make a decision how long you're going to read for. It's helpful. Third.
Go to a place where you can be alone with the book, uninterrupted and quiet.
Okay. Is that possible? For those who live in the house, maybe it's a little hard, but the temple has many corners you can hide in. Okay, so yeah, this is very important. Go to a place where you're uninterrupted and quiet. Next.
Make yourself comfortable, but don't fall asleep.
Okay, that's self-explanatory. Next.
Cultivate an appropriate attitude.
So what would be appropriate attitude? Go back to the previous slide. Believe. Okay. No, don't you go back. We're going back mentally. Okay. Number five. Number six. Prayerful mood. Number six.
Before starting, you may offer prayers.
Now, Srila Sanatana Goswami has written four very powerful prayers in glorification of Srimad Bhagavatam. You can read those prayers, and they set the stage for your approaching Srimad Bhagavatam. Or you can offer individual prayers before you read. Next.
When you are ready, begin reading. Read aloud or silently.
How many of you like to read aloud? Good now. How many of you like to read silently? Some of you put your hand on the phone. Depends on how you feel, right? Okay. When you are ready, begin to read. So it's not like one is better than the other. What works for you? That's the important point here. Number eight.
Read until a word, a phrase, or an idea strikes you or catches your attention. Strive to understand it deeply.
Yeah, so it's not about trying to get a lot read. If you can understand what you're reading, and this is one of them, think about what you're reading, something that catches your attention, read it again, think about it, see about how it relates to you. Okay?
When your time is up, offer obeisances and try to recall any realizations that may have been offered to you.
Okay, so recapping through reflections on what you read. Okay?
Assimilate into your life what you have read and realized. Read Srila Prabhupada's books in this fashion as much as you can.
So these are very practical steps on how to, you know, read Prabhupada's books. Anyone want to add anything to those 10 steps or make some comment in relationship to that? Yes.
I like step one, decide
what you're going to read.
waste so much time in indecision. I think just pick any book and read it, that's good.
Okay. Yeah, you have to choose, because there are so many. It's like you're in a sweet shop and you're thinking, which sweet is the one that I really want? They're all nice. But different flavors for different persons, yes. Yes, Brother Bhakti. So try to understand so you can present it to someone else. In other words, you're thinking in terms of using that knowledge for helping others. Good point. Yes, Bhante?
So, how to make ourselves comfortable and not to fall asleep?
Yeah. I mean, you have to work with that. Like I say, just don't fall asleep. If you get too comfortable, the tendency is to fall asleep, yeah. So, practical suggestion how to avoid that? Have good lighting in the room like that. Sit up straight. And don't get into a very, you know, reclining chair. Unless you really want to go to sleep. So yeah, so you have to arrange your environment so you don't fall into that. And that happens to always do that.
Don't eat too much.
Don't eat too much before. Yes, good. Yeah.
I find it useful to also summarize what I read.
Yeah, that's part of this. This will number mine, so too. Go back to them now. Is that similar?
What I meant was more, say, read multiple paragraphs, try to bring out the core points in a very simple.
Keeping a pencil and paper there, and summarizing some, taking some summary notes. Yeah. And then you keep those notes, and you can reflect back, and then you'll always remember what you learned in that time. Okay. Yeah.
I was recollecting from some devotee. He said that when reading our attention, we are not focused. So use your finger while reading. And also, whatever paragraphs we read, Prabhupada always mentioned, you know, very relevant points in our paragraphs. So try to summarize and write title on whenever reading small books of Prabhupada. So write some small title for that paragraph. And second reading, get into
the don't write in the books. No. The books are not written by Krishna. You don't want to scratch up Krishna's body by putting all these little marks on it. Some people write in the books. I think it's offensive. That's not good. I think these shastras all need to be underlined. Yes.
Yes, I have one point that's important in reading and understanding properly. It's essential to have a proper attitude in the association of devotees, you know, a loving attitude, and that will help your reading.
Okay, the Buddha Vaishnava culture, saying that will also inspire. Yeah, that's a whole other point, but the point is that everything that we do is connected to everything else we do in one form or another. Yes,
yeah, I just wanted to add on to what you said. I mean, with the electronic way that we can read, then we can actually put some bookmarks on specific paragraphs, so it doesn't have to be.
I'm just not familiar with that. But if you're going to make any type of notation, do it separately from the shastra. Not on the shastra. You can put these little, what we say, markers. Yeah, but don't write on the book.
Maharaj, you said underlining is
okay,
writing,
you
said
you
should. Not on the book, no.
Not underlining?
No. Highlighting? Because it's all absolute. You might as well just underline the whole book. It's all transcendental. But you're thinking, oh, this is. So, if somebody gives me a book to read and it's been underlined by other people, it diverts my attention away from what is being read. So I think you can find different ways to take notes. But what I do is I read one verse from Srimad Bhagavatam, I look for a particular point in the verse, and then I copy that point, I copy and paste it onto another file. And then I keep a listing of that chapter, Bhagavatam, separate. And I highlight it outside by just copying and pasting and making another file of that. And it's just as easy, it doesn't take much time. Okay, next. Okay, one more.
Reading with devotees and getting the most out of what you read. First read and or hear as explained before, then repeat and explain among others. Ask relevant questions. Discuss from all angles. Apply what you learn in your life.
So these are some steps and share experiences. Reading with devotees, getting the most. Read, hear, repeat, ask questions, discuss, apply, share. Okay, different way, different systematic procedures on how we can take advantage of the knowledge. Okay, next. Okay, someone. What to look for when you read. Next. So you have knowledge, skills, values, and attitudes. So within the category of knowledge, there is memory, understanding, realization. Within the category of skills, personal application, preaching application, theological application. With values and attitudes, there's faith and conviction, evaluation, mood, authority, academic and moral integrity, and responsibility for learning. So you can divide the knowledge into these three categories: knowledge, skills, values, and attitudes. And these are the subcategories that relate to that. This slide is setting the stage for what's coming up. And you see here, what is this? Can you see it? It's more like question marks, okay. Trying to recall, trying to understand, trying to realize. Here, Prabhupada is doing something, applying the knowledge in action. Here, it is the values and the attitudes that come. A mood of prayer, a mood of devotion, and then the different categories there. So, any questions on this? This is quite complex, because each one of these requires an explanation. Yes? Is that a hand up?
Is that a moral integrity?
Which one? Which one is that?
Yeah.
Academic and moral integrity, yeah. These are part of the values that we glean or get from reading Prabhupada's books. In other words, if you don't have an understanding of how it is integral or integral to moral and academic values, and that helps to develop these skills. The Prabhupada's books are both transcendental, all practical, academical, moral, so from different categories of understanding. Some values and attitudes. So if you're reading Prabhupada's books and you don't know how to behave, that means you really don't. And you're not understanding what Prabhupada's saying. So this is about behavior, this is about activity, devotional activity, this is about understanding. Okay, does that help a little? It's a little complex. Next slide. Okay, so, no, don't do that. Okay, so when you read, so when you read, what happens? You get okay. Does that make sense? Next comes one button. Then you try to understand this knowledge. So understanding is next. Then you try to apply that knowledge in your day-to-day life. From the application comes realization. Why don't I have realizations in Krishna consciousness? Because I'm not understanding what I'm reading, and I'm not applying, therefore realizations are not coming. The last one, and higher thinking skills and values. In other words, you start to develop Vaishnava qualities, and you also, your consciousness becomes more and more transcendental. So these are the progressive stages. Read, understand, apply, realize. This will come automatically through application realization. You don't have to really work for this. You have to work to apply, you have to work to understand. And these last categories are more or less automatic. As soon as application is correct, then realization and higher thinking and skills and values automatically develop. Hare Krishna, say something? This is really right down to your line, right? This is what you do. Very correct. That's understood. Yeah. Okay. Parma?
So sometimes realizations also come by not applying.
That's called special mercy. That means something happened in the past and now it's manifesting in the person.
What I mean to say is that there are two kinds of realization. There is positive realization, there is negative realization. So
well,
when
both realizations
are beaten or sufficient in the
well, if you realize that there's no happiness in material life, then that's a realization. That's a negative realization, right? Shiv, you want to comment on that one? No. So what were you saying in terms of...
Yeah, I'm just trying to say that, realizations also come by getting beaten up in the material energy.
In other words, realizations come by experiencing the negative. It says that no illicit sex, so you have illicit sex, you think it's okay, and then you get crushed and smashed and kicked and punished. Yeah, so that's good realization. But if you don't learn, then what happens next? And then it comes on heavier next time. Yes.
And how do we understand that whether those realizations are backed by Shastra?
You confirm it with Shastra.
Yeah, so material, like outside people who don't like read books, spiritual books, they do get realizations, but
the thing is their tendency is not to change. Because they're under the influence of the material energy, and the material energy pushes them to act in the same way that they did before. The only way they can change is uproot that desire. The devotee has higher consciousness, and therefore, even though the desire is still there, and even in the materialists, sometimes they try to avoid getting the same reaction by avoiding the same thing that caused the reaction. But unless they uproot that desire, it'll happen again automatically in the course of time. That's mentioned in the sixth canto of the story of Ajanya. The whole idea of praschitya, the atonement doesn't really change anyone. Punishment doesn't change anyone. What changes people is purification of that, of the heart. Yes, ma'am.
Sometimes we do get realizations by observing others also.
Yeah. from the example of others, yeah. That's a very prominent form of learning, you know. But, you know, the Shastras also say that the Panapika Pashiti, that people see what they don't see. They see that by doing this, people are suffering, but still they do it. And they expect that it won't happen to them. That's foolishness. But those who are a little bit intelligent and are concerned, they can say, oh, this happened. This person committed a crime. They went to jail. If I commit the same crime, then I'm going to get the same result. So you learn from the experience of others. Or even in a positive way. A person who becomes very fixed in their chanting, they develop nice Vaishnava qualities. So say, oh, let me do that. I can see this person's making a nice advancement. What is their lifestyle? What are they practicing? So we can learn from the positive, we can learn from the negative also. But the best way to learn is from hearing. It says that, you know, experience is the best teacher, but a fool learns by no other means. In other words, you can learn by experience, but if you want to really avoid the negative experience, just hear the truth coming from a person who can speak the truth. So that's why it's important to read and hear, because then we get that knowledge and we can avoid what we need to avoid and apply what we need to apply if we have faith. But sometimes our material tendencies are so strong that they overshadow our intelligence. We know what's wrong, but we still do it. But how do you avoid that? Good association. Even if you're not able, even by hearing, to overcome the tendency to do something which is not good for you, but if you take association with devotees, that association will give you the strength and help you. But if you go away from the association, the devotees are trying to struggle on your own, then it becomes quite hard, practically impossible. Okay, so thank you. That was a nice point. Okay, next. Knowledge. We're talking about those three categories: knowledge, values, and skills. And what was the other one? Attitudes. Yeah. So now knowledge. So there is. We're going into the categories. Theoretical facts form the foundation of the ongoing process of Krishna consciousness. So this is just an emphasis on what we already were exposed to. Next. Understanding. Read. Someone. So certain qualities are needed in order to develop understanding, a thoughtfulness, introspection. Don't look at it just from one point of view, but look at it from different perspectives. It helps to bring about understanding. Okay?
To hear and explain them, the books is more important than reading them.
Oh, okay. A very powerful statement. Read that again.
To hear and explain them, the books, more important than reading them. One can assimilate the knowledge of the revealed scriptures only by hearing and explaining. Hearing is called shravana, and explaining is called kirtana. The two processes of shravana and kirtana are of primary importance to the progressive spiritual life.
Hear, and then try to explain and assimilate this knowledge. Process shravana leads to kirtana, and kirtana leads to what? Smarter, remembers. If you're only doing hearing and you're not repeating, then it's very difficult and practically impossible to develop memorization. There was a Gallup poll taken in America that people will remember 5% of what they read. No, 10% of what they read. They will remember, you know, 5% of what they read, 10% of what they hear, 20% of what they see, 50% of what they hear and see together. So when you combine visual with audio, memory goes up to 50%. People remember 70% of what they do and 90% of what they teach. Here's the point. That if you repeat what you read, then memory, recall, jumps up high.
Does that mean that we should have more PowerPoint presentations because people retain more by seeing and hearing?
I think so. Mm-hmm. I think they're more effective in bringing about people's memories. That's my opinion. I think so. Mm-hmm. And they're becoming more and more prominent now, PowerPoint, on all different subjects. Okay, any questions regarding this one? Yes.
So in the previous slide, when it was mentioned that one should analyze it from different perspectives, sometimes the devotees may start reading many other books to develop those perspectives. What would you say about that?
So you want my opinion whether we should read other books? I think we should read those books that are about the same points that are within the society of this time. So Prabhupada said that the acharyas wrote books, and it's our duty to write commentaries on the books of the acharyas to explain that same knowledge and from different angles of vision. So yeah, so keep it within the society of Islam, because sometimes when you go outside, you get a different mood, or you get a the conclusion is different. The conclusion is not about love of God. It's all about, you know, developing some jnana. That's my opinion. Next. Okay, now this is an exercise. You all ready for this one? This, everyone can get involved in this one. This is an exercise. Okay, we're going to discuss what is being presented there. So someone read it, and then we want different devotees to explain what it means. Nice and loud.
The Kripanath, or miserly person, wastes their time in being overly affectionate for family, society, country, etc. In the material conception of life, one is often attached to family life, namely to wife, children, and other members, on the basis of skin disease. The Kripanath thinks that he is able to protect his family members from the death, or the Kripanath thinks that his family or society can save him from the verge of death. Such family attachment can be found even in the lower animals who take care of children also. Bhagavad Gita 2.7.
Okay, so what is being said and what is not being said? It's important to understand what is being said and what is not being said, because you could understand it in different ways. So any comments? What is being said and what is not being said?
Talking about what is being said is that the Kripanas are miserly people, they basically give up the chance by engaging in skin disease and overly affectionate for material things. And then what is not being said is like the opposite, where someone's utilizing their human form of life, which is like very valuable, to attain spiritual Krishna consciousness.
That's correct. But there is also another opposite. Yes, Radhabhati?
It's not saying not to have love and affection.
It's not saying not to have love and affection for family members. If you take it that way, you're reading it wrong. What is the point that is being made that one should be wary of? Either we're overly affectionate for family members, and it mentions a type of person. So what is that person? What's a miserly person? When you say from miserly, does it mean somebody who hides money in his mattress? No, what does it mean? Yes, Krishna Kirtan?
That he has wealth that he doesn't use properly or at all. So the family man has time and energy that he's not applying the spiritual direction because it's overly absorbed.
There's one major point that's being mentioned here, so I'm not going to study it.
I think its point is that human life has higher purpose and probably not using the human life.
Right. What's being said here is that their whole life centers on the family. And they become attached to family members, and they think, and what is the result of that type of attachment? They think, can save them from death, can save them from everything. And so what's the difference between persons who act like that and the animals? No difference. As you can see, the same symptoms in the animals, they take care of their, you know, most animals, they take care of them very much, but they don't have any higher knowledge, nor can they develop higher knowledge. So one who is miserly means that they don't understand broader principles. Kripana, and then there is, Brahmana. Brahma means broad intelligence. Kripana means stunted or little intelligence. Prabhupada said, brain filled with cow dung, nothing into it. Okay. So any other points here that we can add to this discussion? What is skin disease? Is that just a cliche or what? What does it actually mean? Yes, Hari Prasad.
Seeing things through the external consciousness, attachments to the body, seeing everything in relation to the body.
How is that contrary to higher knowledge? Is there another type of materialists who are not like this but still materialists?
Higher beings?
Yeah?
The higher beings?
Okay. That's generally correct, but requires some explanation. Impersonalists? They're spiritualists. Although they don't have a complete understanding of the absolute truth. And then this is really for those who are really on the bodily concept of life. And they center their whole life simply around the family members and society, and they make that their whole world. Their whole world. Okay? That's the next one. Go back. Okay.
It is not blindly accepted, this Krishna consciousness. With considerable deliberation, we take the decision. Lecture Bhagavad Gita.
So, Prabhupada said, you know, be convinced by your intelligence. Be convinced by it. In other words, if you don't understand something, get the understanding in one way or another. And therefore, you become convinced. Of course, it's going to go into the whole idea of blind faith. It comes up in the later parts of this. What is blind faith? What is intelligent, developed faith? But this is one point that Prabhupada mentioned. Don't accept everything blindly. Think about it, get some understanding, hear from authority, make a decision. Okay. Any questions regarding that? The acquisition of faith and knowledge? Anything? Okay, next slide. Who's that? From where? Who knows? Not in Dhabi.
Mysore.
Okay. I didn't know. You've given me a little more authority on my presentation. Great, I appreciate it. That's why I asked. Beautiful. Krishna Balaram Ki Jai. Next. Personal application. We're going through that list now. The next one is, we went through understanding, now personal application. What does this have to do with you? When you read something, or you hear something, then what does it have to do with you? And then, someone read?
To apply the Krishna consciousness theology with reference to your external practices and internal development so as to develop appropriate Vaishnava qualities and behavior.
Yeah. So there's two aspects of your application and how it affects your external practices, how you conduct yourself in your service, and your internal development. A lot of times we see devotees, they're very good externally, but they have no realizations internally. They can't really speak on their philosophy, or they can't really stay fixed because they haven't developed. So our service is meant to give us, the knowledge is meant to lead to service, and the service is meant to develop this understanding. And this understanding needs to develop these appropriate Vaishnava qualities and behavior. Okay. Any questions regarding that? Next. Okay. Here's our friend down here. Okay. Go ahead. Someone?
Cynthia quoting verses like a parrot will not be very much beneficial. One must apply jnana vijnana sahita. So we must know the vijnana, how practically. This is taught by the verse always.
Yeah, so our friend there, he can learn a verse, but if you ask him what it means, you're not going to get much out of that. So yeah, you can teach a parrot, and you can memorize something, and that's nice, but at the same time you have to go to the next stage, which is understanding of what you're reading or what you're hearing. And then samitam means the complete process. Jnana, hearing, applying, realizing, and then samitam means what?
Together.
Both of these together, jnana and vijnana. Okay? And there's Srila Prabhupada's mother. Next. Who's that? Radha Shyam Sundar Ji Ki
Jai.
From where?
Vrindavan.
Next. Preaching application, that's next. Now we're talking about now the application part. So, what's the difference between these two?
Looks like some
time and place.
Yeah, looks like some scholars on the picture on the left and some hippies on the right.
Yes. Yeah, that's obvious. Is there any difference between these two?
Yeah, color and display.
Yes. Vocal Andrew, what did you say?
One is color and display.
Okay. and one is more spontaneous. Very good.
One is the beginning, and one is further.
This is the beginning of a moment, but actually there's no difference. The point is they're both preaching. To apply time, place, and circumstance to the audience that you're preaching in. So you think, well, I can only preach like this. And therefore, when the hippies come in, I give them, you know, the philosophical knowledge of Brahma Samhita and the sutras. In other words, if you are fixed in only in one way, that's nice, you just do that. But you can't apply that in all circumstances. Okay, so preaching application next. Here we go, something Prabhupada is saying.
I wish to encourage all my disciples to very carefully learn this philosophy of Krishna consciousness, because there are so many preachers who will be required to bring this message to all corners of the earth.
So Prabhupada is kind of begging us to take up this, this process of Krishna consciousness, and because there is a great need within the world, Vaishnava compassion. Okay, next.
The process is that you should memorize the purports of my books and then speak them in your own words.
Okay.
Do not adulterate or change anything, then you will be the perfect preacher.
Hmm. So if you speak it in your own words, how does that correlate with the next sentence? Do not adulterate or change anything. What is not being adulterated or changed? When you speak it in your own words.
The message, the meaning.
So you can say the same thing in different words according to the audience that you're trying to reach. Yeah? Yes, Prabhu. Is it Chaitanya Dika, is it? Vrajendranandana.
Vrajendranandana.
Das. Das. Thank you for clarifying. I know a few other people who have the same name. Go ahead.
Maharaj, here Prabhupada writes that you should memorize the purports of my books.
Yeah.
So like, how?
How do you memorize it? Have you gone to college before? Some of these guys here, they memorize everything, you know, these IT guys. So if you're going to school, sometimes you're required to memorize the lesson. So when it comes time for the test, you can give back that knowledge. So this is spiritual education. We're going through a school of training. So memorization is part of learning. It's actually a conclusion of learning. It's to both memorize, but memorization also should include realization. The problem is saying memorize when it's not that you should memorize all the purports. That would be, you know, impossible. But memorize a few of the purports and then you can speak in your own words. Pick one purport that really inspires you. Read it, memorize it, and then speak it according to your own levels. What this does is activates our intelligence, and then anyone who responds to what you say, you can answer perfectly and convincingly. Because you have the equipment. Is that okay?
Like some practical tips on that, like
how to memorize?
Like you read on a regular, like if I read, like let's say on the fifth chapter, I will forget something, you know, few things that I read in the third chapter.
Right.
So like, what is the?
Prabhupada saying, pick something, read it, memorize it, and explain it. It's not saying that you should just go on with reading and then no memorization. Do do that as an exercise. That's not a feature of a regular program where you memorize each verb part. I mean, you could do that if you wanted to. But pick a few verb words and memorize it. It's like, I know pretty much one verb word in Bhagavatam. I think it's more fundamental. It's fourth canto, 30th chapter, verse number 8. Purchetis. Lord Vishnu is talking to Purchetis. And Prabhupada's talking about unity and diversity in the purport. And he's talking about that sometimes, you know, in the material world there cannot be any unity. And then he uses the example of the United Nations and trying to bring about unity, but they all have separate flags and separate interests. But he says that even we see within the spirit of society, there is a difficulty of applying unity and diversity. He says sometimes because of that, we cannot have that unity. Why? What is the tendency? Because people are leaning towards material tendencies. Or they have a different opinion. So then he goes on to explain how to develop unity and diversity. It's a very beautiful first one, and it's all about Vaishnava Seva, how to develop Vaishnava Seva and Vaishnava culture. So I don't know each of the words, but I can repeat the essence of the first one. So everybody can do that. I'm sure everyone has a particular first one that they can speak on. Okay, next. Theological application. Someone?
To help create learned Vaishnava theologians who are expert in assisting the society through application of Shastric knowledge to a wide range of personal, social, moral, topical, and theological issues.
Okay, that's self-explanatory. We want devotees who can speak to theologians in different categories and have a very clear understanding of the different aspects of our philosophy. Yes? Okay, next.
The Bhagavad Gita is spoken by the Lord so that human society can be perfectly organized from all angles of vision, politically, socially, economically, philosophically, and religiously. From any point of view, human society can be reformed by the Krishna consciousness movement.
Yeah, it's not just a philosophical movement or a spiritual movement. It's a transformation of the whole social environment, which includes the economical and the philosophical aspects. When you read our books, and you find all these topics we mentioned. What does Prabhupada talk about economics? Yeah.
And he talks about how communism fails because ultimately some people will give money kind of to everyone, and that, you know, spiritual communism is, you know, like Krishna be the proprietor of everything.
Right. Okay, that's one point. Where else did he talk about economics?
Civilization and transcendence. Is it civilization and transcendence?
Civilization and transcendence? Yeah, but that's a compilation of his purports from the Srimad Bhagavatam from the second chapter and the first canto. Yeah. So he speaks just like Isha Vashamidam Sarvam, Yatkin Chatyam Jagatina Jatina Bhumi Jahamagirahakan Sridhana. That one should live according to their needs and not more. If one lives according to their needs, what is the result? They can aspire to live 200 years. So living according to your needs allows you to become very successful in all other areas of life, especially spiritual. Okay? Most people live outside of their needs or below their needs. Okay, next. Where is this? Anybody? Salatua, huh? Yeah? I don't know. another slide I wrote here. Krishna Bhavanaya Swami. Okay. Next. Okay. Here we go. I'm going to speak a little bit about faith.
Faith is the complete conviction that simply by serving the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna, one can achieve all perfection. After reading Bhagavad Gita, one should give up all other engagements and adopt the service of the Supreme Lord, Krishna. If one is convinced of this philosophy of life,
that is faith. After reading Bhagavad Gita, one should give up all other materialistic engagements, and based on that faith, based on that activity, one develops faith. Here, how is mentioned?
How is faith created by association with devotees?
Next slide. Yeah, go back.
Sometimes this is taken out of context, like, you know, you come by the mind, you give Bhagavad Gita and you say, like, after reading Bhagavad Gita, one should give up all engagements and adopt to the service of the Supreme Lord.
Nothing wrong with that.
But then they don't want to read Bhagavad Gita sometimes, you know, like, why would I, like, it's hard to convince them, like, how do you explain this?
Oh, they're not, they don't want to read it?
No, but they might get discouraged, right? They say, if I read this book, then I have to give up everything.
Oh, I'm afraid of losing material attachments. Yeah, well, therefore we present things in a very systematic way. That's why, as people come, they should be individually cared for and seeing how to move them from one step to another. That's why we have different programs for bringing people in. We're very good at preaching, but we're not really good at bringing people in and moving them from the next, from one stage to another. And we think, all right, they're in, good luck. Here's the feedback. This is the schedule. This is the time for prasadam. And then, you know, after a while, where'd they go? So there is a whole systematic program that needs to be implemented in such a way that when people come in, they can get whatever they need to move to the next stage. That's something we haven't done as a society. It's being done in certain areas. Like I go to the Ukraine. Every Sunday feast, they get at least 20 new people. It's like, on the average. And so one time they had actually 48 new people for the Sunday feast. And so then someone will meet them, talk to them, get to know them, give them a book, take down their information, invite them to future programs. So there's a whole, what we say, a broad consideration of how to move persons from one stage to another. It takes personal care. You can't just bring a person into a society, they're interested, they're attracted. You have to really allow them to have the association they need so they don't get exposed to the wrong ideas or get exposed to the right way, the right thing in the wrong way. It's important. Sometimes we call that bhakti program, but it's more than that. It's called Vaishnav care, caring for the devotees. And that's not only in the temple, that system can also be implemented into the congregation also. The congregation would have to do that amongst themselves, kind of a system of, you know, bringing people into programs within the congregation and taking care of them. So they continue to come and learn more and make nice advancement. So yeah, that's where we are a little weak as a society. Okay?
Queen Kunti prayed, I wish that all those calamities would happen again and again so that we could see you again and again. For seeing you means that we will no longer see repeated births and deaths.
So what is this in relationship to? What? What was the last slide? Faith. She has complete faith that, you know, I don't care what happens. Let it come, and these will help me develop my faith for you. Because she's praying from a particular angle of vision, because she has everything materially. And she's afraid that because she's well-situated material, she'll forget Krishna. And she's praying for some change in her material situation. That way she can remember Krishna and then at the same time be free from repetition of birth and death. This is a very powerful prayer. It's not like everyone can make this prayer. But if you can make it, honestly, you can't just say, Krishna, let the command of calamities come, and then when they come, you say, whoa. But I don't think you need to do that, because all you have to understand is this world is full of calamities. That's obvious, especially in America. A lot of calamities happening all the time. So therefore, all we have to do is stay fixed in Krishna consciousness. We don't have to pray for calamities. But if you want to, you can. Yes, Krishna Kirtan.
Lakshmi Mani actually told us in Canada this year that they wrote to Prabhupada asking whether they should pray for calamities. And Prabhupada wrote back saying that there was no need to pray for calamities.
Really?
The calamities will come at their own.
Yeah.
Thank
you for confirming that. They'll come automatically. Next. Here we go. This is again the principle of faith.
Whatever the case, we must have faith in the word of Krishna. When we purchase a ticket on Pan America or Air India, we have faith that the company will take us to our destination. Faith is created because the company is authorized. Our faith should not be blind, therefore we should accept that which is recognized.
Yeah. So we have faith in the spiritual master and Krishna because they are authorized spiritually, and therefore we can accept what they say and also serve in that movement. So that's not blind faith. Prabhupada uses a material example to show how we apply faith even in a material manner. Next. Jai Shri Shri from Vrindavan Ki Jai. Next. Where's that? Who knows that? Everybody knows that. Shri Bhakti Vedanta Manor in London. Next. Evaluation. So we're going through these different things we've never listed before. To help you develop analytic, interpretive and evaluative skills, particularly in respect to practical application of Shastra knowledge. Learning how to evaluate work. So who's this person here? Great thinker, right? Materially. He was always evaluating, analyzing, interpreting. And here we have the same thing in the spiritual realm. The great sage who studies the books and presents the knowledge in these ways. Okay? Evaluation. Next. The road leads many ways. Someone?
Develop the ability to make appropriate choices in your personal life. The ability to give advice or counsel, etc., is actually relevant and practically useful to society.
Study, one can develop what we say, giving advice and counsels to others. Some of us like to do that service, to advise and counsel others. It's important to to study the scriptures and then evaluate based on our study and then learn how to apply it according to the situation. So we have advisors, counselors, gurus, like that. Okay? Here we go on faith again, and evaluation. Read.
Although Krishna advised Arjuna, kill him, Arjuna did not take it. This is consciousness. Even though there is duty, we have to see what will be the effect of that duty. Nothing should be done blindly. This is the nature of a devotee.
So what is Prabhupada referring to? What story?
Garden.
Huh? In the back? Aspatama. When Aspatama killed the five sleeping sons of Draupadi. Five sleeping sons. Then they captured him and they decided what Krishna said to kill him. Arjuna didn't immediately respond to that. The Prabhupada said he was thinking what would be the effects of killing him. So Prabhupada said, he's making a point that if you're going to do something based on the instructions, you should also know what will be the results. And if you're not sure of the results, or you're not happy with the implied results, then what do?
Question.
Yeah?
Submit a question.
You ask for a question, you get your doubts clear.
Did Arjuna end up killing the person or not?
No. You read the story, it's in the 7th chapter, the 1st chapter. Okay. It's a very interesting pastime. Go ahead. Yes. Yes, please.
You could question
any instruction, but that's ultimately you have to follow what is the answer to the question. Yeah, Prabhupada mentions in the Bhagavad Gita 434, blind faith, and what is the other thing?
Absurd
inquiries are, rejected. So blind faith, in other words, if you're not sure, you have some doubt, question it. But it's not like you challenge it, you question it. And how you question it is also important. In other words, submissive oral inquiry into the nature of the question or the instructions. But you're asking me to do this, and I don't really understand what is the intention or why I should do it. Can you help me? If it's done like that, then the person will think, oh, this person is intelligent. Maybe this requires some more explanation. Or your question may also bring out a certain point that comes up by way of seeing. In other words, if I do this, this is going to happen. So I don't think this should happen. And that person may also change the instruction. It happens many times. That the person giving you instructions will consider what you say and change or alter the instruction. That's accepted, but then also the principle of blind faith is also being questioned. Because a lot of times, if you just do things blindly, after a while you develop no intelligence. Prabhupada wanted us to be able to understand why we're doing what we're doing and what is the result. So that's a particular point that's being made. So you see in this presentation, even there's contradictions in what is being said. because we're looking at it from different angles and visions. Okay, where's that? We go back again. Back again. Okay, next. Where's this? You got the right country, but it's not Bhakti Vedanta Nagar. This is in seven very place in the very beginning of the movement back in London. This is in the old days around 1969, 1970. This is before we had Bhakti Vedanta Nagar. Okay, next. Mood and mission now. We're going through that list. Okay.
Understanding and appreciating the mood and mission of Srila Prabhupada and perpetuating that understanding within the ISKCON Society and its members.
Okay, continue.
Understanding of Srila Prabhupada's mood and mission gives you a clear sense of identity and purpose within the society and a balanced sense of one's place within ISKCON's overall mission.
Okay, so you see, these are different ways that our mission is being propagated. What do we have here?
Distribution.
Channel distribution.
Deity
worship.
Kalyan.
Cow protection. Farm communities. Yeah. So understanding, if we don't understand Prabhupada's mood, and then the mission that he is giving us, you know, we will somehow or other just maybe add somewhere what our own ideas are, or not understand why he's giving us this particular. Some people say, well, we don't need farm communities. All we need is money now. You hear that sometimes? We don't need Vaidarshan Dharma because Vaidarshan Dharma is material, and therefore it's all we need is to be transcendental. Here's how they become transcendental, you know, or deity worship. But Prabhupada included everything. Therefore, his mission is quite variegated because he wanted to, you go back to that one statement, he wanted to make a complete alternation of the entire society. Economically, politically, socially, spiritually, religiously, morally, the whole thing has been changed. And of course, you know, how to live in a very, an environment that is conducive to Krishna consciousness. Okay, next. Either directly or through the words of the great souls. And then what is being rejected here? This pretentious attitude that I can simply go to Vrindavan and live in the holy place and then I can find Krishna there. This is pretense and this is some sahajism. Taking things cheaply. Prabhupada makes the point twice. Following the words of the spiritual master, he will see the Supreme Lord without difficulty. What is that verse that came up earlier? You know, that faith and that dedication to the words of the spiritual master brings about realization of the Supreme Lord. It's so important. Next. Akitamoku, a moral integrity, we're going through that list, okay.
In studying and preaching the scripture, it is necessary that we have moral and academic integrity in the interpretation, evaluation, and application of Shastric knowledge.
Yeah.
Doing what is right, even when it is difficult.
Mm-hmm. That's called integrity. One who lives by values and integrity actually lives. One who lives simply to satisfy the immediate needs has no place anywhere, even in the jail society. So having academic, sticking to the knowledge that is given, and moral integrity. Again, in other words, that integrity means not only do I repeat it, but I live by it. Okay? Any questions about that? Next. Examples of poor or dishonest use of scripture. Okay. Here we go. Whole new section. Here's what are some of the examples of poor and dishonest use of scripture?
The tendency to quote only half a sloka when the second half modifies.
Okay. So any examples of that? Kamane Varika this thing, Mahalachi, but which mean? If you say just the beginning, what is the name?
You're entitled to do your duties.
Just do your duty.
Yeah. You have the right
to. Well, now, work is worship. Okay? And then the next?
The personality of God had replied, the renunciation of work and work in devotion are both good for living.
This is an example. Next.
But of the two, work in devotion, devotional service is better than renunciation.
So that's a verse, but this is the next one that qualifies what is being said previously. Okay. Next. So you see, without this is not understandable. So if you say work and devotion are both good for liberation, it's correct, but then it says of the two, one who works in devotional service is actually included renunciate of worship of work automatically. Okay, another form of poor dishonest use of scripture is
choosing and quoting only verses, evidence that support our own opinion and neglecting others.
Exactly. Quoting is choosing verses that support our own opinion and neglecting other ones.
Okay.
Okay. When I only come to devotional service, I have no more responsibilities to anything material. But then again, if you're living in the Vyasa life, you do have responsibilities. But that's not material, that's spiritual. Okay? Choosing and quoting. Here's another example.
Citing context, relevant materials as absolute truth, or quoting out of context.
What would be another example like that? Well, all women are less intelligent. That would be wrong, that's taking out of context. Next.
Arguing or debating largely or wholly on the basis of emotion.
So some people are good at doing that. They can acquiesce great emotional energy and present their argument in that way, and they use that in order to convince others. Okay, another one.
Quoting a verse that doesn't actually explain that which they are discussing or whose meaning is unclear and or ambiguous.
Example? Hare Krishna. Quoting a verse that doesn't actually explain what you're discussing. Give an example of what you're discussing and then pick a verse that doesn't apply it. Puts you on the spot. All right, it's just a bit of Vedatattva. So, everything is simultaneously one and different? Okay, good, very good. It's all one, we're all Krishna. Prabhupada said that in one lecture, you're all Krishna. What does that mean? Is you're all part and parcel of Krishna, you're also coming from Krishna. In the same sense, you are also a spiritual being. And, but that doesn't explain the whole point. It is that you're actually not Krishna at the same time. You are Krishna and not Krishna. But you're more not Krishna than you are Krishna. Because you're not Krishna, but you will have the same qualities of Krishna. At least it's more qualities. So the Chittaveda-Vedatattva principle is it has to be explained from both angles, not just from one side. It's all one or it's all different. There are so many human beings, therefore everyone's a human being, but not everyone is the same human being. Okay. Alright, so these are, here we go, some more. We're getting to the end, so I know it's quite long, but we're almost at the end.
Somebody is misusing the word, so aham, aham brahmasmi, and therefore I am the supreme. But that is not. These are Vedic words, but so aham does not mean I am God. So aham means I am also the same quality.
Yeah. So the word so aham means I am that. But what is that? The supreme. No, it means that I have the same qualities of the supreme. Or another example is Nirguna. That the supreme Lord is Nirguna. So the persons that use that, they say, God is without any quality. But the explanation is Nirguna means no material qualities. And not just no qualities. Okay. Another example. Where is that? Bhaktivedanta Manor, Shishi Radha Gokulanda. Next one. Responsibility for learning. We're getting, this is almost to the last one.
We must take responsibility for our learning and develop healthy study habits, developing a taste and appreciation for the study of Srila Prabhupada's books and understanding the relevance of Shastra within one's life. Will inspire us to study and study well. Understanding how we learn and what we must do to facilitate our learning will assist us in developing the study skills necessary to learn.
Developing a taste, appreciation, understanding the relevance helps to develop responsibility for learning and brings skills and study skills. Okay? Okay, here's that same verse again. Yeah, so that verse is again repeated. Okay, Shishi. Okay. One should develop the ability to see through the eyes of scripture with Krishna consciousness, but the ultimate goal is to realize Krishna's presence in everything and see his hand in everything. What is that verse? Vidya Vinaya Vihastini Suni Chaiva Supakecha Pandika Samadarshi. So seeing the soul in the different types of living beings. That is called seeing through knowledge. We see with our eyes, but we should see with knowledge. Okay? And it's tough. Okay.
Personal realization does not mean that one should, out of vanity, attempt to show one's own hearing and own learning by trying to surpass the previous acharya. he must have full confidence in the previous acharya. And at the same time, he must realize the subject matter so nicely that he can present the matter for the particular circumstances in a suitable manner. The original purpose of text must be maintained. No obscure meaning should be screwed out of it. Yet it should be presented in an interesting manner for the understanding of the audience. This is called realization.
Yeah. Keeping moral integrity, philosophical integrity, re-understand, and then present according to time, place, and circumstances. Don't try to create your own meaning. Should be done interesting and for the benefit of the audience. Okay? So, this is a summation. Summary.
Knowledge and understanding, personal application, preaching application, faith and conviction, Prabhupada's mode and mission, evaluation, academic and moral integrity, responsibility for learning, Shastra Sakshus or realization.
Yes. That's it. Push the button. So that was it. So that last was the summation of what we went through. So you can see that it's more than just reading. It's more reading, understanding, learning, applying. Application brings realization. Realization brings qualities. Qualities bring us to the spiritual platform. Qualities and knowledge, just realization of knowledge. So, read Prabhupada's books. I would suggest, if you could, set up a little study group so you read two or three devotees at a time and just discuss. Pick a section from the books, sit down, read. We have so much things that we're doing that we can, you know, push aside. And just, once you get interested into this philosophy, see that this philosophy works in such a way, if you're not in it, you can't really see it. But once you get in it, you don't want to get out of it. It's so sweet, it's so powerful, and so inspiring, that we need to develop this, what we say, routine, when we start reading and studying. Once you get into that, then your whole Krishna consciousness takes on a whole different understanding of how everything works. And then you're not bewildered by situations anymore. We get bewildered because we just don't have that knowledge based on experience. Or we just don't have the knowledge at all. So every situation, you can apply the knowledge and see situation according to that knowledge that's applied. Okay? Thank you for staying through the whole thing. I know it was about 2 hours. It's a long presentation, but we did this in Mayapur a couple years ago, and it was well received, and it was appreciated by many of the senior devotees. So this and it comes right down to keeping Prabhupada's spiritual legacy alive and keeping Prabhupada also in the forefront. Because you see in the very beginning that if we don't keep this mood of reading, studying, understanding Prabhupada's books, then Prabhupada becomes more like an icon in our society. He started it, but he's no longer here, and now we have to move on to something different or something. Something else. It happens with every spiritual movement. The founder, and the Madhvacharyas, and the Ramanujacharyas, they make sure all of their participants read and study their founder's books. That's why they're still strong in their practice. The Madhvites and the Ramanujis, they're very strong because they make their books course of study for everyone who's involved in that society. And keep that legacy alive. It's important that we do that. Especially with such an informational overkill noise everywhere. We have a tendency to look outside for other knowledge. But everything is in Prabhupada's books. We were mentioning yesterday how whatever question or concern or topic that one can possibly bring out, Prabhupada spoke of. He said something in relationship, either through his books, conversations, or his just interactions with devotees, answering questions. Covered everything. So whatever question that one may come up with, you can find it somewhere in something Prabhupada said or did. So it's there. Then therefore we have everything we need to progress in spiritual life. This knowledge is really, what's the word? It uplifts your consciousness. Okay, if anybody wants those 10 steps on how to read the books, I can send you a copy of that. I made a separate file for that. I can't give anybody out this thing because it's copyright. If you want the permission to have this, you have to see the author. If she approves, then we're good. Yeah, she's doing it that way. She doesn't want it just to be thrown around to everybody anymore. Only those who are serious about this can get a copy and use it for themselves or use it for preaching, especially for preaching. Your Guru Maharaj came to me. He found out about this. I did it in Chicago. He asked me for it. I said, see Lakshmi Bodhi. I asked on his behalf, and she said yes. So he has it. So. He was really inspired by this. He really liked it. So. It's complete in terms of Prabhupada's books. Prabhupada's all right, I don't know whether to tell you to take breakfast or get ready for lunch. So thank you for coming. It was actually Vanamali Prabhu's decision to have this presented. So.
Last couple of things. So, Prasad is definitely upstairs. Go and eat.